Hey, Pastor Santos, Sister Nancy. Hi, guys. I like coming to the early service when I can. My wife didn't get a good night's sleep. She only had a couple hours, and she finally fell asleep, I think, around 5 o'clock, and I was up the night, too. But I got up early, so I said, I'll go to the early service again. Just, you know, she's resting, so keep her in prayer. And we're praying for everybody who's going through struggles and times right now, because it's a crazy time. And as I was waking up this morning, and I appreciate when they give me 3, 4, maybe 5 minutes to talk, but I was feeling like a little anxiety and worry and fear was coming out because of something that happened just recently this week. And you know, the devil likes to take advantage of any little negative thing that comes into your life, whether it's a person that says it to you. It usually comes from somewhere that's really not from God. Okay, let's put it that way. And, you know, worried about, like, oh, the dark times ahead, and somebody even used the word dire straits, and we could be in trouble, and this and that, and this and that. And I was kind of like, oh, gee, yeah, you know what? Oh, boy, what if that does happen, and this happens, and that happens? And all of a sudden, all this stuff goes on in your mind while you're laying there, 5 o'clock in the morning till 6 o'clock. And then all of a sudden, I said, wait a minute. I said, Lord, you've got something, you've got a solution to all this. Why am I even this? He said, and all of a sudden, I felt like the Holy Spirit said, where are your eyes fixed? Where are your eyes fixed? Are you fixed on that? Are you fixed on what that person said? Are you fixed on the economy? Are you fixed on the new president? Are you fixed on the world situation, on the global crises that are going on? Or are your eyes fixed on the kingdom, on me? When he said, seek first the kingdom, and I was like, seek first. That doesn't mean try to find it. That means put that first before anything else comes in your life. And the kingdom of God, I looked up the word 154 times in the New Testament. Most of it was Jesus himself talking in all the Gospels. And it was always the kingdom of God is here. Kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God has come among you. Go preach the good news of the gospel of the kingdom. Go lay hands on the sick and they'll recover. Cast out demons and let them know the kingdom of God is here. And it's without observation. He said the kingdom comes without observation. They're going to say, lo, where is it? Where's the king? Where's this kingdom? They're looking for a throne and a physical ruling government. It's not. The kingdom of God, he said, it's not here. It's not there. It's inside of you. It doesn't come with ocular confidence. That's what the word means, with observation. It doesn't come because you see it. It comes because it's there. It's a realm. It's a royal realm of authority, of blessings. Jesus said that we've been blessed. Ephesians 1:3, Apostle Paul said, we've been blessed with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. The heavenly places is not just way out there. The heavenly realm, it's a realm that we are citizens of, living in, occupying this space of the realm of the kingdom, and we bring that light of the kingdom into the darkness of this world, and we bring the authority of the kingdom into the chaos of this world and take dominion over it, like he said we were supposed to do in the very beginning, that we lost because of sin and so on and so forth. You know the whole story. But he encouraged me this morning. He said, fix your eyes. Fix your eyes. That doesn't mean just every once in a while when you go to church on Sunday, when you do your daily devotions, when you throw a Christian program out. When my eyes are fixed, no matter where I'm going in this world, the kingdom is first. Then I look at the problem. I'm not unrealistic of problems. Some people said, I'm a realist. I only deal in realism. I look at the paper. I look at the words. I look at what's there. I look at the numbers. I look at the report. I look at what I see. That's not what we're supposed to be doing as Christians. We walk by faith, not by sight. Because the things that are seen are temporal, but the things that are not seen are eternal. That's how Apostle Paul got through all his trials and tribulations. He had his eyes fixed on the prize, on Jesus, on the kingdom, on just the word kingdom means that there has to be a king. And if we keep our eyes fixed on the king of the kingdom, realize that we are citizens, we are joint heirs, we are brothers and sisters in the Lord. Our spiritual family is more powerful than even our flesh and blood family as far as the authority of the name that we have been given on this earth, because we have a new name. It's written in heaven. And I can't wait to see what that new name is. I know somebody said they found out what it was. I kind of think I know, but I'm not going to say anything. All right, Father, we just thank you so much for the encouragement you give us in our times of worry, fear, anxiety, and doubt, when our eyes are fixed on the wrong thing, when we are looking to earthly solutions, Lord God, when we should be keeping our eyes on you. And then when we see you first, the kingdom, we go back to those earthly situations and we can handle them, we can deal with them, we can take authority over them, we can believe you above those things so that we're not under. And we thank you so much, Lord, that you've made us joint heirs with you of everything that we'll ever need in this life, whether it's spiritual, physical, emotional, food, finances, whatever it is, Lord, our eyes are fixed on you, and we know that we're living in a kingdom, a realm that is on this earth, but it's not of this earth. And we are in this world, but we're not of this world, because we belong to you. And we thank you so much that you'll never leave us, never forsake us. You're faithful to the very end until you call us into eternity with you. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen.
Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not, as Thou hast been, Thou forever will. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to Thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. That endureth Thy own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings are mine with 10,000 beside. Faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand has provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Our faces down, our hands are raised. called us out. We turned away. We've turned away. With shipwrecked faith, the idols rise. We do what is right in our own eyes. Our children now will pay. Shine your light. If we've ever needed you, Lord, it's now. Lord, it's now. We are desperate for your hand. We're reaching out. We're reaching out. Church arise, let your church arise. If we've ever needed you, Lord, it's now. Lord, it's now. We are desperate for your hand. We're reaching out. We're reaching out.
Could there have been a more appropriate song? If there was ever a time when we needed God, if there was ever a time when this country, this world needed God, it's now. It's right now. Wow. It's good to be in the house of the Lord today. Amen. 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 We're going to be receiving our communion. You know, I'm excited about. When we said we were going to have communion for 7 weeks, that's what I felt the Lord put on my heart until Palm Sunday, which is, it's coming up pretty soon. Easter's around the corner. Easter's early this year. It's early April. So we are going to get your communion ready because we're believing God that this whole pandemic garbage is going to end. And God is going to bring it to an end that it's going to shock the world. I know the vaccines are coming, and we're thankful for that, and we're thankful what men can do. But I know what God can do. And when man gets puzzled, God is just, you know, he probably laughs. You know, men struggle, and God has the answer. And it's such a blessing to know that he does. It's such a blessing to see some of our people back from their battles with this virus. Charlotte, it's good to see you back. Marilyn, it's good to see you back from your surgery and everything. And those that are going through, that came through this, you know, we're so thankful that that their cases were mild, except, you know, for our dear sister Mary, and we miss her. We miss her so much. I see her face, you know, no matter where, no matter what service we were having, no matter what the weather was, she was there. He was just there, and we miss her so much. But you know what? I don't know how much she misses us because she's with Jesus. I don't know how else to say that. You know, we always want to say that she's in the, yeah, but she really is. I mean, it's not just a saying, you know, well, she's in a better place. Well, she really is. Oh, yeah, yeah. Oh, hallelujah. Get your communion ready. We're going to receive this communion. Pray this prayer that was given to us. I really enjoy praying this prayer with you. Thank you, Father, for the gift of your Son. By the stripes that fell on his back, my body is healed. From the crown of my head to the very soles of my feet, every cell, every organ, every function of my body is healed, restored, and renewed. In Jesus' name, I believe it and I receive it. And Jesus, the Messiah, took the matzah, broke it, gave thanks to the Lord his God. And Jesus said, Baruch atah Adonai, Eloheinu melech haolam, hamotzis lechem min haoretz. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who brings forth bread from the earth. It was then that the Messiah added these words, This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Let us eat together. Meditating on the broken body of the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Thank you, God. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for not changing your mind. Submitting yourself to the will of the Father, going all the way and staying on the cross for us. For if you didn't, we would have no hope. But because you did and were obedient to your Father, we want to be obedient and recognize what you did and discern your body for our healing, for our salvation. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your precious blood, your sin-free, disease-free, poverty-free life is in your blood. And your shed blood has removed every sin from my life. Through your blood, I am forgiven of all my sins, past, present, and future, and made completely righteous. Today, I celebrate and partake of the inheritance of the righteous, which is preservation, healing, wholeness, and provisions. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for loving me. Amen. And amen. And Jesus took the cup of redemption. Just as the blood of the Lamb brought salvation in Egypt, so Messiah's atoning death can bring salvation to all who believe. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, bori pri hagafen. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who creates the fruit of the vine. Let us gratefully drink together in the name of our Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus, so much. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Amen. Just want to make one announcement this morning. Tomorrow is our first step towards maybe some kind of normality. We're going to have our men's and women's Bible study tomorrow at 6:30. Men will be downstairs. The women will be right here in the sanctuary. And I'm excited about that, taking that first step toward getting back to some kind of normal church services, okay? So we invite you to come. And I know that we will maintain social distancing. We're going to be as safe as we possibly can be. And we're going to be excited to be here. Amen? If you have your Bible, if you turn with me to Gospel of Luke, the 13th chapter, we're going to be in that chapter for a few minutes today. Is that all right? Lord, we just thank you for the opportunity we have to share your word again. And we sure don't take it lightly, God. And the things that you spoke to my heart during this study of this lesson, I just pray, God, that you'll give me more clarity and more patience as I get excited and I want to see these things done now, and maybe it's not the time. But God, in your time, the song that we used to sing, you make all things beautiful in your time. Please show me every day as you're teaching me your ways that you'll do just what you say in your time. So thank you, Father, for that. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen and amen. You know what? As pastors and preachers, we perform a lot of wedding ceremonies in our time. And I've seen, performed a lot of weddings in the last 35 years. And I've seen a lot of things. Seen a lot of crazy things, right, Pastor Tony? We've seen a lot of, I've seen a groom faint right in front of me. I knew he was going to do it. You know, I'm looking at him and I said, this guy's going to go down. And then he went down. You know, I've seen that. You know, and I've seen, you know, I've seen brides that were so nervous that they were laughing through all their vows, and I didn't know if they were taking the wedding seriously or not, and we just continued right on or whatever, you know. And I, you know, and I heard that one pastor asked the groom to repeat. He said, repeat after me, I take you to be my lawful wedded wife. And then he looked at her, and the guy said, I take you to be my awful wedded wife. He says, it was an accident, you know. You know, really, we've seen it all. You know, we really have. I think I've seen everything. I don't know. Maybe I haven't. But I haven't seen, except for one thing I've never seen. And the one thing I've never seen is an unattractive bride. They give incredible attention to how they look. Their makeup is perfect. Every hair is in place. Their nails are great. They're color coordinated with everything else. They have their outfits planned for months in advance. I have never heard of a bride getting up on the morning of her wedding and say, I wonder what I'm going to wear today. I've never heard that. See, why I'm saying that is because Jesus says that the church is his bride. Isn't that a vivid word picture in light of what I just told you? When you think about it, the church is the bride without spot or wrinkle or any other blemish. And Jesus, the groom, says, I love the bride. I love the church. And so should we. Amen? So with that in mind, for the next few weeks, we're going to do a little mini-series. Like, we just finished a mini-series about making Jesus the Lord of all these areas of our life. And we're going to talk about Jesus being the head of the church. Okay? Jesus is the person who is married to the bride, to the church. You know, maybe someone's asking, if you're watching this or whatever, the question, you know, tell me more about this Jesus. You know, could he be Messiah to me? Could he be forgiven for... Could you be forgiven for your most unknown secrets? Or could you take away my fear? You see, Jesus is the head of the church. And listen, his thoughts, his word, his actions dictate the direction of the church. And that's what we have to go by. That's what our plumb line is. It's what Jesus thought, what Jesus said, the actions he did. Okay. So as minister, as a senior minister, my job is as a teacher and a spokesman. The Bible says in Ephesians 4, Jesus said in the church of apostles, prophets, evangelists, and pastor teachers, or some say pastors and teachers, but it's technically pastor teachers. And the staff help facilitate our mission. But Jesus Christ is the head of the church. So what does that mean? We hear the expression, but what does it mean? What does it look like? And in the next several weeks, we're going to be answering that question. And today, we're going to take a closer look at Christ's church and how We are to be a place that meets people's needs. And that's the first thing we're going to talk about. We're going to look at a story today, how Christ responded to a woman in the synagogue in Luke 13. We read that he heals her, right? And it's kind of strange, because the strange thing about this healing is that the church leaders are not happy about it. Instead, they were kind of ticked off about it, actually. And so we're going to dig into this story. And while we look at it, we're going to keep in the back of our mind what the purpose of this church is. And I wrote something out. It's kind of like a mission statement, something I want you to get, because I believe this. I believe this is what we should stand for. And I asked Ron to type it out, because I typed it out, and here it is. You got it? Is it on the board? Bethesda Full Gospel Church exists to do four things: to evangelize the lost, to edify the saved, to meet the needs of others, and to be the conscience of the community. I want the community to know what we stand for, that we are a lighthouse in this community, and what we do and what we accomplish here. I want us to be the heartbeat of this community. You see, but the third arm of our purpose says that we exist to minister to the needs of others. One of the four main objectives of us as a church is to be a place where needs are met. So let's see how Jesus meets these needs, and let's make some observations and learn from him. Is that okay if we can learn from Jesus today? I think it's okay. The first observation is that he had awareness, not apathy. He had awareness, not apathy. What I mean by apathy is apathy means like indifference or lack of concern or lack of feeling, lack of emotion. He had awareness, not apathy. Look at verses 10 through 12 of Luke 13. It says, one Sabbath day, Jesus was teaching in the synagogue. He saw a woman who had been crippled by an evil spirit. She had been bent double for 18 years and was unable to stand up straight. When Jesus saw her, he called her over and said, "Dear woman, you are healed of your sickness." Now, the first thing that we can do as a church is to notice those who have needs. Jesus saw. He saw this woman, and he invited her to come. He calls her out, you know, come, you know. And sometimes this is the opposite of what we do sometimes. See, the opposite of love is not hate. The opposite of love is indifference. It's apathy. It's lack of feeling. It's lack of emotions. There are a lot of special needs that the people within the church have. There are people that are grieving. There may be those that are struggling with chemical dependencies. Some people are new to the community. They don't know anyone. There are people who have maybe problems at work, or maybe their child is rebellious, but most of those who have special needs are also lonely. And they're searching for friendship. Someone who will just notice them as Christ noticed this woman. Okay? Mother Teresa said, "What the poor need even more than food and clothing and shelter, though they need those too desperately, is to be wanted." They need to be wanted. I doubt if this woman that Jesus sees has felt very wanted or felt very cherished in the relationship in the past 18 years of her illness, because community sometimes could be so cruel. Isn't that right? It can be cruel, those who are less healthy or maybe less attractive. But the sad thing is, you know what? Churches sometimes can be downright cruel when it comes to that as well. But as Christians, we need to have our antennas up, and we need to be on the lookout for those who are in need. And so the question is, how could you go out of your way to express kindness to someone? Someone says compassion always involves a risk and a reach. And I thought, that's true. And that's why the church is here. I don't know what you're going through, and I don't know what pain you might be experiencing, but here it is. The message of the cross and the purpose of the church is that no one here should have to carry a burden alone. That's what I believe for our church. No one that comes here should have to carry their burden alone. Amen? Awareness, not apathy. All right. But there's a second observation, and that is compassion, not competition. Jesus was just eager to show compassion. He looked for opportunities to show compassion, but he did more than just look. He followed up on it. He followed up, and you know what? We don't always do that. We don't always do that. Have you ever been in a worship service or in a place where someone near you was overcome with emotion, maybe during a song, and you see them weeping or they hear something in the message and the emotions take over, and you're there and you think, you know what? Afterward, you think, I bet they're going through something. I bet they're having a bad day. Oh, I sure hope somebody talks to them. Well, you're a somebody. I'm a somebody. And we do nothing? Okay? You see, the Pharisees were jealous of Jesus' popularity and his power. They were jealous. They were in competition. He was hurting the business of the religious leaders because he focused on love while they were focused on the law. Notice what Jesus did in showing compassion. And this is where it really starts to get to me. He does two things that I feel like we've been robbed of by this pandemic, and I don't know what to do about it yet. Yes. Pastor Tony knows exactly what I'm going to say. First, the first thing Christ did, he expressed compassion through touch. Through touch. Look at the 13th verse of our text. It says, then he touched her, and instantly she could stand straight. How she praised God. Wow. I mean, think of what must have been like to see a person who has suffered for 18 years and in a matter of seconds to be miraculously healed. He touched her. Now, I know the counselors will tell you that inappropriate touches can be powerful and they can wreak havoc physically, emotionally, sometimes for years. But an appropriate touch can be so affirming and can be so encouraging. And from a psychological perspective, touch is very healthy for people. Someone said, never underestimate the value of a handshake or a hug or a pat on the back. And we need to understand that the importance of a touch is, it's not some modern idea that someone thought of, but back in the first century, the Hebrews living in Palestine, they recognized Jesus as being a great teacher. And what did they do? They brought their children to him that he may lay hands on them, that he may touch them and bless them. And all through the Gospels, this is what it says. In Mark chapter 10, remember when Jesus says, let the children come to me. Don't forbid them, for such is the kingdom of God. And it says the people brought the children to him that he would touch them and bless them. And I learned something when I was studying this message. I never heard of touch receptors. We have in our body, they say, millions of touch receptors. And they say that one-third of all of the millions of touch receptors are centered in our hands. I thought, wow. And studies have shown that a touch can even lower a person's blood pressure. Just a touch. And I started looking in the scriptures, and it says in Mark 16, you shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. By touch, you know, you shall lay hands and receiving of the Holy Spirit and the laying on of hands. And all through the scriptures it talks about a touch. And that's what Jesus did. And researchers have proven that babies that are handled often develop better emotionally than babies who are not. Through cuddling, holding, hugging, kissing a child, it helps them feel loved for a long time. It helps them understand the meaning of the word love. And that's what Jesus did. Jesus was always reaching out, touching those who were in need. Did you know that Jesus even touched lepers? He did. Now, we can't understand that. In our culture, that doesn't mean much, but Jesus touched lepers. In Mark's gospel, the first chapter, before he heals the man of leprosy, it says before he heals him, he touches him. He made himself ceremonially unclean. But it meant a lot more that he touched that person. It meant a lot more to him that he touched that person. That man had not been touched for who knows how long. Who knows how long? So Christ expressed compassion, first of all, through touch. And you know, when I read that and I wrote that and I thought, that's one of the things that this epidemic has robbed from us. It's robbed from us. We can't, you know, we're not supposed to, and we should. This is different. I know it's different. And I don't want to see anybody get COVID. I don't want to see anybody because we insist on hugging or whatever. But I'm mad. Because that's something that the church is founded on. Laying hands on someone, blessing them, blessing someone, praying for someone, anointing them. I missed it. When this thing is over, we're gonna have a prayer line. I'm gonna have an oil bottle about that big, baptize people in oil and whatever we're gonna do. We're gonna lay hands on it. All right, let me go on. But he also expressed compassion. First through touch, and then through time. Through time. He got involved. Jesus got involved. Someone said charity is more common than compassion. Charity is tax deductible. Compassion is time consuming. Time consuming. Verbal affirmation is good. It's good. It's a good start, and it can lift a person's spirit. But usually, the time or the energy spent is more beneficial for the person in need. And Jesus was excellent in all these areas. And I thought about, well, just think about the woman at the well, right? I mean, in John chapter 4, he spent time with her. He had a conversation with her when there was a period of time. You didn't talk to women, especially during the daytime. You didn't, but he did. And he had a conversation with, he spent time with her. And think of the woman that was caught in the act of adultery in John chapter 8. They brought her out before Jesus. Everybody's ready to throw rocks at her, except for the one who could have started throwing the rocks. Instead, what did Jesus do? He talked to her. He says, woman, go. Don't sin no more. You know, leave your life of sin. He talked to her. He spent time with her. He spent 3 years pouring his life into 12 men. 3 years. What did he do during those 3 years? He served them. He served them. He you know what? He knocked himself out for them. He spent time. I heard of a mother who was preparing pancakes for her son. Two sons, Kevin, 5 years old, Ryan, 3 years old. The boys began to argue about who would get the first pancake. And their mother saw the opportunity for a moral lesson, and she said this. Now, if Jesus were sitting here, he would say, let my brother have the first pancakes. I can wait. Ryan turned to his younger brother and said, Ryan, you be Jesus. I thought that was good. You be Jesus. You know, Satan loves to whisper, hey, you know, let somebody else do it. You know, let somebody else, you be Jesus. You know, and that's what we say, let somebody else do it. And what happens is, you miss out on the blessing. You do. You miss out on the blessing. You see, the blessing of compassion comes from getting involved in people and meeting people's needs. That's where the blessing comes from. And oftentimes, if you're going through a rough time, you're going through a bad time, you know what the most therapeutic thing that you can do is? If you're going through a rough time, you know what you can do? The best thing you can do is stop having the pity party. for yourself and put the focus and the attention on someone else and minister to them. How about that? You're going through a tough time? Good. So did Job. And I read in Job 42 where it says, when Job prayed for his friends, it says the Lord restored his fortunes. In fact, he even gave him double of what he had. So you're going through a tough time? Suck it up. Stop having a pity party. Minister to someone else. And watch and see what God does for you. Amen? There's a third observation that I see in this passage. And that is, there are bottom line solutions, not Band-Aid remedies. Sometimes churches can be notorious for this, trying to put a Band-Aid on something that is cancerous and needs so much more attention. Look at Luke 13, verses 14 through 16 with me. Would you do that? Here's what it says. But the leader in charge of the synagogue was indignant that Jesus had healed on the Sabbath day. Indignant means he was livid. He was mad. He was resentful that Jesus healed her on the Sabbath day. He says, there are 6 days in a week for working, he said to the crowd. Come on those days to be healed, not on the Sabbath day. But the Lord replied, you hypocrites. Each of you works on the Sabbath day. Don't you untie your ox or your donkey from its stall on the Sabbath and lead it out of the water? This dear woman, a daughter of Abraham, has been held in bondage by Satan for 18 years. Isn't it right that she should be released even on the Sabbath day? Do you see what's taking place here? Jesus heals a woman and the people get ticked off. You know why they got ticked off? Because it was a Sabbath day. And you see, they saw healing as work. Because healing was a part of a doctor's profession. I read in the Life Application Bible, it says, for this paragraph, it says, the Pharisees hid behind their own set of laws to avoid love's obligation. I thought that was really good. And that's exactly what they did. The religious leaders were so upset about breaking the Sabbath. That's all they were upset about. He's breaking the Sabbath. And you know what's so ironic? It's so ironic that according to their stupid laws, you could help out an animal on the Sabbath, but you can't help out a person. Duh. I mean, does that make any sense? Man's law, you can help an animal, but you can't help a person. Did you notice how Jesus referred to this woman? He called her a daughter of Abraham. See, Christ was always exalting women. Back in the time when women were not exalted. You remember several weeks ago we studied in Luke chapter 9. We learned that Jesus was always concerned about the total person. Always concerned. Look at, take you back to chapter 9 verses 1 and 2. And look at the second verse. Luke chapter 9 says, one day Jesus called together his 12 disciples and gave them power and authority to cast out all demons and to heal all diseases. In verse 2, look at verse 2. Then he said to them, he sent them out to tell everyone about the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. What did he tell them to do? Read it again. He told them, tell everyone about the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. I told you, Tony steals my messages every time he says this, so does Kathy. But what was he telling them to do? He was telling them to preach and to heal. To preach, to teach, and to heal. Spiritual healing, physical healing. Jesus was able to help this woman and to heal her. And you know what? I believe that that is still a part of the commission of the church today. That's what I believe. We are called to preach, to teach, and to heal. And to be determined that you will do whatever you can do to minister to that person's need, the one who is hurting. Amen? Amen? But you know what we run up against? We run up against two extremes. Two extremes. The first extreme is those who won't ask for help. There are those who won't ask for help. There are people who, and these are people who desperately need help, but they would never ask for help. Maybe they're embarrassed or maybe they They feel guilty or awkward letting the church help them, or maybe it's a pride problem. You know, I don't need anybody's help. And usually, it's just, well, you know, there are bigger things that other people have to worry about. And sometimes it's just out of kindness. So they just don't ask for help. But there's another extreme, though. You see, some people are hesitant to ask for help, but there's another extreme that is there, that people who demand help. A person who is demanding help will say, you know, listen, you just drop what you're doing. You know, my need takes priority. Forget your guidelines and your policies. I need help. And you wouldn't believe some of the requests that come from people with a different attitude than Christ's attitude. And churches sometimes can be taken advantage of, believe it or not. If we just handed out money, food, and clothing time and time again to the same people with no accountability, we would become enablers and not ministers. The goal is to help people become self-sufficient if they have financial needs. The goal is to help the person who's going through emotional problems to come to the point where their soul finds rest in God alone, in Christ alone. You see, the church is not a welfare agency, you know, and people in the church are not your mom and dad. They're your brothers and your sisters. That's why we try to meet the needs of those around us. Because the Bible says in Galatians chapter 6 and verse 10, it says, therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. Amen? Let's look at one final observation. It's the fourth observation, and that is rejoicing, not resentment. Rejoicing, not resentment. Look at the 17th verse of our text when Jesus said this. Remember what he just said to them. And then Jesus said, this shamed his enemies, but all the people rejoiced at the wonderful things he did. You see that? You see, joy is a part of the experience of meeting someone's needs. If you meet someone's needs, guess what? You are joyful. You are excited over it. But you know what else happens? They are joyful. Jesus was thrilled at changing a person's life, and the people, it says, rejoice. The Bible says back in the 13th verse that when he healed this woman, it says that she praised God. She praised God. You see, celebration is a part of the abundant life. You need to have some mountaintops to counteract the valleys of your life. Amen? So the Bible says, rejoice. And Paul says, and again, I say rejoice. So the parallel for the church is the obvious one. When people's needs are met, there should be rejoicing. There should be celebration. In Luke 15, the chapter concludes by saying that even the angels rejoice in heaven when a sinner repents. And we quote that scripture a lot. You see? Let me bring this to a close. You see, we can become so self-conscious that if we're not careful, we might not ever celebrate victories. But the early church certainly did. They did. And I believe we should too. And I believe that Bethesda is a special place with special people where God's Spirit is being poured out. You see, Bethesda isn't a perfect place. And you won't find a perfect church. If you think you found one, as soon as you joined it, it's not perfect anymore. But it needs to be a place where people's needs are met. That has to be a goal. That has to be our goal. So maybe the question in your mind today is, could he be Messiah to me? Could he be Messiah? And the answer is yes, he can. And he promises to meet all of our needs according to his riches and glory if we put our trust in him. Amen? And if you've never turned your life over to Christ, we invite you to do that today, to confess your sins, to be willing to repent and actually to be baptized into the body of Christ, to become a new creature. The Bible says, if anyone be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new. Amen? Let's all stand together. Thank you, Jesus. We took the first step into understanding why Jesus is the head of the church and how he demonstrated the things that we need to demonstrate if we're going to be the church of Jesus Christ. That's what I want for our church. The greatest compliment that I've ever received in over 40 some years is when I hear people say, I felt loved when I came to your church. People said hi to me, and it broke my heart, because I've heard some people say that they went to churches for a while, for weeks and weeks, and I think Marlene told me one time that people didn't even say hello to you. But I never want that. I want us to be a big family. Yeah, so we're a big family. But we're gonna do what God has called us to do. We're gonna preach the word. We're gonna lay hands on the sick. They're gonna recover in Jesus' name. Amen. Father, thank you so much for today. As we close our service today, God, as we've been trying to leave this building with worship on our heart, and I know that the songs that we sing, if we ever needed you, God, it's now. And so as we raise our voices now, I know we have a song that we're going to close our service with today, just before we pray the benediction. So let's worship God with this beautiful song. Ronnie, in Jesus' name.
Though the tears may fall, my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. Though the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. Cannot feel your hand in mine, the faith arise to you. God of mercy and love, I will praise you, Lord. Now you shine with glory, Lord of light, I feel alive with you. In your presence now I come alive, I am alive with you. There is strength when I say,
Now that's the way to end the service. That's the way to end the week and begin a new week. Let the joy of the Lord be your strength this week. Amen? Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you. Give you that incredible hope that we have because Jesus rose from the grave. Give you that joy that we just sang about that's unspeakable, full of glory. The joy of the Lord is your strength. And allow him to bestow upon you the peace that only he can give. Not the peace that the world can't give you. The world can never give you a peace that God can give you. Because he gives you himself, the Prince of Peace. A shalom peace that passes all understanding. We can be at peace in the midst of an epidemic because our God is still on the throne and everything falls under his directions. So we thank you, God, for today. Thank you for your people. Bless them, God. Let them have an incredible week this week, being a witness for you, sharing the love that you put in their heart with someone this week. Let that love just flow. And we thank you for all this. For we pray it all in the matchless name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And all of God's children said amen. Amen. Put your mask on. Tell someone it was good to be in the house of the Lord today. Would you go ahead and greet someone in the name of Jesus? Amen.